y'all to see that balcony up there. Because soon, one of the greatest luchadors of all time will be dancing up there. And I just feel like you need to see all this. I really do.
This is a special request.
We will be greeted by our signature drink, that is the Palmarita. It's a margarita that we made with carrot juice, orange juice, and a dash of lime juice. So I would like to ask if everybody's having tequila this morning. You are. Everybody is not having tequila. We, okay, because we can make the farmarita without alcohol if somebody wants it, without alcohol. Everybody wants alcohol.
Yeah.
Yes. Everybody. Okay.
Yes. Lemonade, hibiscus,
that's
and water.
That's a coconut. Yes or a no?
Yes.
That's a
say.
That's a double.
Más tequila.
Más tequila.
Okay, so we come back to the yard and we start with the class. We will prepare a burnt skin salsa. We will prepare a pico de gallo and one guacamole. We're gonna do a lot of tasting throughout the class, but I will ask you to save some room for lunch and don't spoil your appetite completely doing the snacking, because then we have a full lunch. Our full lunch today consists of coleslaw, seasonal salad, cilantro rice, and beans, and the Baja fish tacos. We have key lime pie for dessert. So another important thing to ask for us is if anybody has any allergies or food restrictions, something we should be aware of to accommodate. Is anybody gluten-free or fish and seafood? Okay. Okay. We can prepare
vegetable.
Yes, probably Ellie. Pollito, no?
Pollo,
sí, pollo is okay. Okay, yeah. So we can prepare for you some green chicken tacos.
Perfect.
Okay, very good. So, well, I think we can start and we can go on the tour. The yard is. The yard is the first home of Patrick and Gloria Green, who are the owners of Flora Farms. They are originally from Sonoma County, California. Gloria is a third generation farmer, and Patrick is in the building industry. So they had this wild dream of coming down here to the middle of nowhere, because this was in the early 90s. I mean, now it's a different town, but in the early 90s, it was just middle of nowhere, and do organic farming. It's funny because at that time, there were farmers, of course, in the area, and they were doing pretty much organic farming, but they didn't know, and they weren't like having the organic flag as a selling point, because it wasn't booming yet, the organic food movement. Maybe in San Francisco, but here in Mexico, everything gets 20 years after, so. She was a pioneer. She was a pioneer, and both of them chose this specific piece of land because it has its own well, a water well, which is pretty important if you wanna do farming. We are in a desert area, so we cannot rely on municipal water. I mean, not even if you just have your little house, because the water service is pretty deficient. So this was an abandoned pig farm that with the well. That means that while it had water, the soil was very depleted of nutrients. It wasn't like a good fertile soil. So there was a lot of work involved in nourishing the soil again until they could actually harvest a good crop. And that happened probably 5 years after they started experimenting and putting things in the soil to make it more rich. Eventually things worked out, and by the year 2000 she established a little cafe in town where she would make the best chilaquiles, and she was obviously using her own products. So local chefs started to take notice that there was organic produce available, and they could taste it in her cafe, and they started asking for her to supply the restaurants. So slowly, I mean, everything took off, and she started planting more and harvesting more and selling to restaurants. By the early 2000s, the farm was getting more green and beautiful and more plants. So they started hosting the events or fundraising for the Humane Society. They are both dog people. They love dogs and they have a lot of dogs and they do a lot of dog activism. So that's how they started doing the events. And then the weddings came and they started to do a lot of weddings. And well, now we do corporate stuff and just all kinds of events. And mango season here is like a big mango fiesta because we really take advantage of all the fruit we have. We will be making mango jam, mango sorbet, mango ice cream, mango bitters, mango syrup, dehydrated mango. We will be making a salad that is mango quinoa and poached shrimp. Like, you get the pictures. We do mango everything. We eat like, because they're so good. So we started keeping them. Back there, we have about 13 beehives, and they are producing honey. And we are using the honey in Tuesday's fried chicken dinner. And I mean, the people that are taking care of the bees, they also provide a service to the community where they go and take beehives that might be nesting in inconvenient places like the front door of your house, which you don't want to have them there. So they go and like rescue them and bring them here. So we have a lot of, they are producing a lot of honey and the honey is delicious. So let's go one plant next to the other to control pests. We grow a lot of flowers for various purposes. Some of them attract good bugs, some of them repel bad bugs, like the calendula flower that is over there. And many of them are edible, like the cosmos, that little white one that is there. You can find it in our salad. We do a lot of rosemary and oregano and strong herbs to keep bugs away. And if we happen to have a pet that is growing hollyhock, together. Sometimes papayas get heavy because they have a lot of fruit, so we use something to support them. If you have this thing with papaya where you don't really like it, I really suggest that you try our papayas because they taste totally different than the one in the States. We have a lot of cherry tomatoes. This season for tomatoes has been like good. We had a lot. Compete for nutrients, so we don't have avocados here. And whatever things like flour or almonds that we obviously don't grow, we buy them from the States from organic suppliers. So here we have some cabbage. We do a lot of cabbage, Napa cabbage, the red one, the white one. We've been doing a lot of cauliflower as well. The white, the green, the yellow, the orange, and the romanesco that is beautiful, and the purple also. Broccoli, we do a lot of radishes. We do the watermelon radish, the black radish, the ping pong radish, and also the beets, the candy beets, the purple beets, the golden beets. We have a lot of fennel that we use in the kitchen. Not everybody knows what to do with fennel, but we braise it and we use it in different dishes. It's really nice. We've been doing asparagus as well that are very interesting because they have to grow for about 3 years and then they start giving the shoots. It grows like a grass and has like big feathery leaves. For tomatoes, we do a lot of Roma tomatoes that are the most used in Mexican cooking. But also we have the heirloom ones, the big funky shaped ones, and the cherries I was just telling you about. broccoli, we've been doing two, and then eggplants. We have the round globe eggplant, and then the Japanese, which is really nice. We do fries with them, like cut them like in long matchstick shape and fried. They're really nice. Let's go this way.
Oh my gosh, that is ridiculous.
No, this one, it's a parmarita. It's fresh lime juice. Some orange juice, splash of lime juice, some Concoy tequila, like the margarita, and some chili flakes. What the?
That's pretty good. It'll
so
what ails
smooth.
Doesn't matter what it is.
It's the tatemada salsa, like the roasted salsa. The second salsa was, the fresh salsa pico de gallo, making with fresh ingredients, with some tomato, onion, and chili pepper, some cilantro chop, and lime juice. After that, we're gonna make some guacamole. We have some special recipe for you, amigos. Then we're gonna make some tortilla with Anita, from the scratch. Anita, te quedo un poco de romero, se me fue el rollito. So the first step, it's a little demonstration how to cook your ingredient for your first salsa. So I have a little demonstration on this side. So the tatemada salsa, the first step is like the burnt skin salsa. So for this salsa, we like to shut really well all the ingredients. So here we have a little grill just for the demonstration, but usually in Mexico we make this salsa when we make a Mexican barbecue, like the carne asada. Mm-hmm. So when we create the grill, we start to cook all the ingredients for the first salsa, for this salsa, not the other salsa. So for this salsa we need some onion.
Cebolla.
Muy bien. You can make this one translate in Spanish.
Garlic.
Oi, ajo.
Garlic.
Yeah, that's what I say, garlic.
I like to to sell the garlic on the shell and the little husk. So when the husk is starting to burn, I check the garlic. It need to put a little more pepper on the side. And when I feel the garlic some soft, it's ready to take out of the fire and peel it and ready to use.
Delicious.
We need some. No.
Chile.
Serrano.
Serrano. Serrano.
We need some chili pepper, of course, we are in Mexico, so we need some chili pepper. This one is like the more popular in Mexico. A lot of Mexican family really love this chili pepper, the serrano. Usually it sounds spicy. And for the people like less spicy or mild version of this salsa, I recommend to use
jalapeño.
Jalapeño usually it's mild, but the truth is we never know the spicy of your chili pepper before you try it. So careful on the chili pepper. Usually this one is a spicy one and this one is a mild one. Then we need some
tomate.
Roma tomato, yes. For the tomato, I recommend to don't overcook on the grill, so don't like waste the juice of your tomato. We like to keep like some moist on your salsa, so we're gonna add all the juice of the tomato on your salsa. So my recommendation is like shred really well all the skin and put in some plate, process to some plate and cover with some plastic wrap, some towel. And with the same heat, it's follow cooking and starting to release the juice on your plate. So you can use the tomato and the tomato juice to your salsa. You can make the shot. The shot is really important, amigos. It's adding like the smoky flavor to your salsa. Some people ask, do you peel the tomato? No, of course not. The tatemada is the burnt skin salsa, so we need the burnt skin salsa, the flavor of the smoky from the skin on your salsa. And that's just for the demonstration, amigos. So you can look the garlic, the onion we have for you guys. We have the serrano and the shot jalapeno. And the tomato with the smoky, really nice smoky tomato juice. So for this salsa, we're gonna start the puerito tool, the molcajete. Starting crushing the onion, garlic, followed with your chili pepper, then the tomato. After that, we're gonna add some cilantro chop. Let me show you how to chop your cilantro before you use this one. And at the end, we add the salt and pepper. At the end, so wait. So this one, it's a Mexican blender. I like to say the Mexican blender, the molcajete. The molcajete, it's a prehispanic tools. It's always making with volcanic rock. So make sure if you want to buy one to check if it's right, real molcajete. Some people find some fake molcajete in the store. Sometimes it's making like by concrete or something like really not good for you guys. The molcajete, the volcanic rock, it's bringing some minerals to your food, some flavor. So that's really good for your salsa, amigos. So to know if your molcajete it's real. That's not fake. The first way is taking your molcajete and feel the heavy. Always the molcajete, it's some heavy.
Okay.
The second way, it's checking the, like each one, you can look, it's never like the same. It's always making by hand. So you can look sometimes the hand tools mark in the bottom and the side. The fake one usually is like all making in one, like compressed in one piece or some mold. Look like all the same, equal the same. So that's a good way to know if you have the real molcajete. Another way is taking your tejolote, the little rock, and crushing a little bit on the bottom. And pass your finger through the bottom and feel like the really, really fine powder. You can smell, it's smelling like volcanic rock, so it's like smelling some smoky.
Yeah.
And that's fine powder, it's all the minerals going to your food, so that's good for you. If you feel like some really big pieces, like some sand or something like that, maybe that's not the volcanic rock.
Oh, yeah.
Is that a tripod or no?
Good, how are you?
Very good.
Happy Sunday.
Yes. Huh? Okay, so you want me to put your ingredients in here?
Might as well.
Thank you.
processor in blender, right?
She can help you, I'm not for you. I can help you too.
No, I'm outside myself.
Anita, she's really strong. I just recommend to both messages, Anita.
You don't need to work out now.
And if you take the tamales class, you make tamales sometimes like for maybe 60 tamales and the big bowl and mixing all the masa by hand.
Lisa did a good job.
So grind the corn in the morning.
It's strong like booze. That's good.
Cerramos muy bien. Amigo, amiga. Serrano.
Sí.
Muy bien. Some people like really spicy. We can mix both chili pepper.
Can I do serrano and jalapeno?
Of course. Welcome to Mexico.
Un jalapeno.
You gotta get all the yumminess in there.
Welcome to Mexico, amigos.
Half of a jalapeno.
Half jalapeno? Like a tiny, tiny one? It's perfect.
Tiny good. One, yes. Thank you.
Amiga?
Oh, I got the
majestad. Yes, amigo. See? Amigo.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And I can see how you'd have one.
And bring some extra garlic for you, okay?
Okay.
You have two chili pepper, right? You?
I got a chili pepper and a habanero and a jalapeno.
One and one, you have?
She just has a half jalapeno.
Half?
Okay.
I
can
eat whatever I wanted.
Yeah,
please.
No. Like a workout.
I mean,
I think a chip.
Hey, she's speaking of chip.
Chili pepper, right? That's what we put in the juice.
Oh, we gotta get it good.
Yeah. Yeah. It's really delicious. It's really good. Sorry? Yeah, it's really depending. No, it's really depending on the heat. You just try to burn the skin. And don't have a cook to the plate. You want to cook it or more. Did you learn in France? Did you learn in German?
Oh my god! You are so
German? Ah, you're. Yeah. You're from, yeah, you know.
Seriously.
Yeah, for fish.
She's 21.
Yeah.
Yummy tomatoes. My daughter is a Fulbright fellow and she's in the Laos in August.
No, not yet. Wow, it's just awesome. I'm speaking the chip.
Breaking the rules.
Fulbright, so she's a teacher. Oh, she's already graduated college.
If you want to keep the salsa in your molcajete, it's perfect for the presentation. It's really nice. Just today we need to use the cutting board, so for that we need to make some room in the table. Mm-hmm. But the last thing is chopping some, we need to chop some cilantro. We need to the cutting board, some pasta on the board. We have some food. We have the same food. Yes, do them all.
Oh, the two more.
There you go.
With the mask, a little more.
Okay. You can put it in the...
We can put it in the same one. We have the same, okay. Same spice.
Perfect. Let me help you with the spoon.
There you go.
Yum. There you go.
I don't miss that spot right there. Get it.
Oh my God.
Get it.
Let's not waste.
No waste.
Yeah.
Got it?
That's one spoon on the table for to help yourself if you need.
Oh, yours is rocking, dude. It's a little spicier than ours because the peppers, you never know what you're gonna get.
On this salsa, just my recommendation is don't add too much cilantro. The fresh cilantro is strong and can kill the smoky flavor of your salsa. So that's not a cilantro salsa. So don't overpass on the cilantro.
Yeah, we call
the
that
cilantro in Mexico, mild. We really love to use the leaves and the stem. The stem is bringing, it's adding some minerals, some nutrients, some texture, and some more flavor to your salsa. So we really love to use the leaves and the stem. We take out the stem only when it's really coarse and fibery, but this one is really tiny, so it's perfect. And tastes really good, so it's perfect to use on your salsa. The cilantro is a fragile herb, so the idea, like, don't overchop your cilantro, don't overpass your knife on your cilantro to don't turn brown your cilantro. So for that, I have a little technique. I like to start rolling a little bit, like that, and turning, making like a taquito, to keep like more together all the cilantro. With my hand, I make a little claw, like that. That's the perfect way to watch around so I can look with my knuckles. So in the kitchen, sometimes we are really busy and checking something around, some common, talking with somebody and checking something in the oven. Or looking for cutting and looking around, you know. Don't do that today, please. Practice in your house if you want. And the idea is like cutting with the sharp of the knife. The cutting, it's always from the sharp of the knife, not from the front of your heart. So I'm not cutting like that. I give a little slicey. See? So don't broth your cilantro. One-way cut, it's a perfect way to keep the green and the fresh of the cilantro. So don't try to cut again and again and again. This is gonna turn really brown. For each salsa, I recommend like a good burn like that. It's perfect for each salsa.
Mm-hmm. I can smell it.
And after to add your cilantro, we need to add some salt and pepper. I recommend to careful with the black pepper. In Mexico, we never add too much black pepper when we work with some chili pepper. Peppers and peppers, it's shot. So just a tiny pinch of black pepper, it's okay. If you don't want to add black pepper, it's okay too. And the salt is always really important on your salsas. It's helping to bring all the flavor from the salt, the smoky pepper. So I recommend to add like two good pinches of salt on each salsa. My pinches are 3-finger pinch. Anita, she makes even more salsa, so I'm gonna add an extra pinch. Okay? So, he's been passing around with some knife. If you chop some extra cilantro, it's okay. We need for the next salsa. For the pico.
I think I got way too much.
Yes. Add the salt pepper. And mix together. Then you have your tortilla chips on the table. The fresh tortilla chips. Cooking in the morning, so you can... For you, salsa with the tortilla chips.
Oh, yeah,
get it in there.
Should I add more?
Yeah.
I didn't even think about that.
But you got pico coming, so you...
Yeah,
you can pizza. You want to put it on mine?
We need to get
some more. Now we're going to have it. That's okay.
There you go. I forgot we were making one combined.
A joint.
Yeah. Now we gotta do the salt and pepper, right?
Tiny pinch of black pepper.
Oh, yeah.
Black
pepper and salt. So you do that part.
What did it say? One pinch?
No, 3 pinches of salt and 1 pinch of pepper, but if you want to amp it up. 3 finger pinches.
Did you actually only just do 1 pinch of pepper? I don't care.
2 pinches of salt, 2 fingers. Yeah, and a tiny pinch of pepper. serrano.
Oh, okay.
Here we have the Sanita salsa. So today we have not too strong chili pepper. The chili pepper is not always like the same spicy. It's not use like the serrano gonna be always the same spicy. It's wrong.
I like it.
You can take the same serrano from the same boring. Yeah. Sometimes one can be really, really spicy.
The spiciness is really good.
Yeah. And it's the same with the jalapeno. Just squeeze all the chili pepper. So if you like spicy amigos, you can try the Anita salsa. It's not over spicy. It's adding really nice kick. And if you don't like spicy, please don't touch this salsa. Chili pepper and the cilantro. So for this salsa, we're gonna work making teamwork today. Two people for each recipe. On each recipe, we need 3 Roma tomato. We need a quarter of onion. 1 chili pepper. I'm gonna pass 2 chili pepper per recipe, but you choose your chili pepper depending what you like. The spicy, use the people like spicy, use the serrano. The people like mild or non-spicy, use the jalapeno. And this one, no sense to mix both together. Always the stronger one, keep the other one. The juice of 1 lime and some cilantro chop. Some salt and pepper as well. So let me show you some technique to chop all your ingredients for this salsa. And after that, we're gonna pass along your recipe and you're gonna start to practice.
So you want jalapeno this time and not serrano.
For the onion, I have a nice technique to cut your onion or chop your onion really faster and more regular. So for the with the quarter of onion, I take out the part of the top, but I keep the part of the bottom to keep all the onion together. Taking the last layer, sometimes it's some bad, sometimes it's some dry, sometimes some chewy. If you need to take out, you take out. Mm-hmm. This one is look perfect. Then I start slicing on this way. Straight to the table, but I don't cut the part of the bottom. See? So when you, after to do that, you can turn your onion on the other plate for like the medium size, like this one. You can just give 2 more cuts in the middle, the same way. Then chop. And that technique is really good to keep the onion juice on your onion into your onion to don't start to cry. I know the men don't cry, but careful with the eye. Sometimes it's really
cool. Cool.
So the perfect way to chop your onion, amigos. Then with your chili pepper, I have really nice technique to clean the jalapeno in 1 cut. So that's really, really nice, really funny. So put a lot of attention. But I did like go around the stem, close to the skin, and cleaning all the center of your jalapeno. For that, I like to take out some part of the stem to just kind of roll my jalapeno, starting slicing on 1 face, on the side of the stem. Don't try to cut on the stem is really hard. Then putting my knife parallel to the table, and the idea like slicing on the bottom and rolling on the top. Let me try to do that slowly for you.
Oh!
Oh.
Technique.
See?
That's so fancy.
Easy?
Yeah. That looks easy. You make it look easy.
It's like this. So, the jalapeno, when you start to clean your chili pepper and touching some part of the spicy of your chili pepper. Please, amigos, take care. Careful, don't touch your face, don't touch your eyes. Wash your hands. You go to the bathroom, careful. I'm not a jerk. Do you know where is the spicy of your chili pepper, amigos?
The
seeds?
No. The fleshy part, the white.
Right?
The seeds.
No.
The seeds?
No.
Flesh.
Flesh?
Both.
Oh. So yes, a lot of people only think on the seeds when we talk about the spicy of your chili pepper, but that's wrong. all the caps in, all the where we produce your spice of your chili pepper, it come from the veins and the membrane, all the right part of your chili pepper. It's where we from the caps in, the spice. So the seed to have contact with this part, with the right part, takes some spicy from here. So for that, the seed have some spicy, but the seeds don't bring the spicy to your chili pepper. So if you like non-spicy and you take some chili pepper, I recommend to clean really well all the membrane, including the seeds, of course, and all the veins of your chili pepper, all the right part of your chili pepper. That's the perfect way to take out the spicy and keep some chili pepper flavor. Sometimes the jalapeno can be really mild, and when you clean the jalapeno really mild, sometimes it tastes like the sweet green bell peppers. Can be really, really, really mild and non-spicy. Not always, sometimes it's a little spicy. For the jalapeno, we're gonna chop, starting making mastic, then chop. See? Mm-hmm.
Oh, you gotta brag with the no look. Yeah, all right.
Then we have the serrano. The people like spicy, I recommend to use the serrano. But the serrano, sometimes it can be really, really spicy, and I recommend to don't overturn the spicy of the serrano. Sometimes you can feel burning the skin of your fingers for maybe 5 minutes, maybe 20 minutes, maybe 30 minutes, maybe 1 hour. So careful.
Maybe the rest of the day.
Not maybe all the day, but maybe a few hours maybe, in case if it's really
salsa. You want hibiscus?
For that, I like to cut on quarter and just follow the line of the meat. Just push a little bit on your tomato. Don't overcut on the meat, just follow the line. And ending by the little stuff. And we're gonna work with this part of the tomato.
Okay, thank you.
You look, I never take the part of the stem at the beginning. You don't waste all this part of the meat of the tomato.
Yes.
When I clean the tomato, I take out the part of the stem, very little one. If you want to use this one for the first salsa, if you want to make some soup, some gazpacho, some pizza salsa, whatever you want at home, you can use this part. And today we're gonna give to the pigs. We have some bucket in the bottom for the compost. So you can make happy some pigs and chicken today.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And the same way of the jalapeno, we slice, making mastic, then chop. Okay. So in this salsa we like to add a good bunch of cilantro. So if you want to add a little more cilantro than the first salsa, it's okay. It's right. And when you have all your ingredients chopped and ready, you can back your stuff to your bowl and adding the lime juice. The salt and pepper is like around the same amount of the first salsa, like 2 good pinches of salt and tiny pinch of lime. Everybody know how to use a squeezer?
Yeah.
You sure?
Can you tell us?
I need to.
Yeah.
You know why? For me, like everybody know how to use a squeezer, but the guy 3 years ago, or 3 years ago, cutting the whole line without cut, starting to press. And I saw him with a wet face and over pressing. What happened with you? It's really hard.
Just eat you.
So really important to cut your line. And this way it's a perfect way to can open all the segment of your lime and releasing all the juice. So the juice is gonna down in these little holes. So we're gonna pass the cut piece on the top part and just press. See?
Mm-hmm.
All right, so Anita and me are gonna pass over your recipe.
Oh yeah.
Remember to make teamwork, 2 people for each recipe.
So you're not gonna want this one too. So wanna help me? Which one? First, did you do the onion first?
Yeah, I
used to. All right, let's see if I remember what he did here.
Amiga,
yeah.
In this side?
Yeah, he had that in.
You don't want?
That's
one
more.
Do you love it? One for each 2 people.
Yes, right.
One,
I think
two.
So. And
not all the way.
The
sorry?
Yeah.
Onion.
You want
somewhere?
Not from here. I'm gonna go find
you. Can pass some.
I'm gonna sit down.
No.
The biscuits I have.
Can we just fold this part?
No.
Esta ya basura. Y esto nomás.
Looking good.
Bien. Okay, con. Sí.
Excelente, perfecto.
Lo va a picar.
Yeah. Okay, now what next?
Yeah, the chili pepper, bok choy, the tomato.
Oh, this one.
Yes, what I'm talking about. He needs to have a little
How's it look then?
And then
matchsticks.
The side, yeah.
The matchsticks.
I recommend to work with a new
She kneaded mine. She like took the meat out.
Did they like slice the
knife?
Slice.
And she said this was basura.
And can I shower it to the table? Put your hand on the top, never on the top of the shampoo knife, and don't press. Be really gentle. Daddy like slicing on the bottom and rolling on the top.
Oh, I see.
Yeah? Don't overpress. Be gently. Be always work with the sharp of the knife cutting.
I got it.
Don't force. Don't try to cut in the stamp. Understand? The stamp is really hard. So keep like the power, the knife power into the tip. Don't press on your hand. Be gentle. When you over force with your hands, it's when you can have some accident. Always try to be gently. If you like to keep some spicy, you can leave, you can leave some part of the white. If you like non-spicy, clean really well all the white parts.
Gracias.
I don't like wasting. So we're making the pigs happy, but I'm a little piggy right now. I just don't want to eat too much and not be able to eat lunch.
What are you doing? Yeah. The pigs eat jalapeno too. They're Mexican. Spicy.
Yeah,
and the onion too?
Yeah.
It's a shuffle in there.
Yeah. It wasn't great, but it wasn't terrible, I guess. Again?
Yeah.
Pretty good.
And then,
Serrano and pineapple, and then,
So in the Pico de Gallo, to the base of the Pico de Gallo, it's what we are making right now. And sometimes we like to add some twist on it. You can add some pineapple, roasted pineapple, some mango, some papaya, some pomegranate, you can add some beans, some guacamole, some watermelon. You can play with a lot of different twists adding in your Pico de Gallo. And depending on the dish, what you want to make, and the season. Here we like to add the mango in the mango season, so maybe in 2 months we're going to add some mango to the Pico de Gallo.
Ooh, yeah.
But right now it's not, so like it's not the ripe mango, so
sure.
We cannot do that. Okay, start with the bottom. And then like, just push. Just open and keep like, cover it to the table, the tomato, and just follow the line. And then, is it this time? Yeah, for the pigs.
I feel like I'm almost there. Do you add anything organic or just certain things?
And if you like ceviche, some people like ceviche. Do you like ceviche?
Yeah.
So for the basic ceviche in Mexico, we like to use the same base of the Pico de Gallo.
But not everything.
Maybe usually adding some cucumber, but you can switch, adding some mangoes or whatever you want. And some white fish or shrimp cooked on lime juice. The chopped fish with a lot of lime. adding a little salt and pepper and keep in your fridge for 20 minutes to 1 hour. Some people like really poor in Mexico and like cook for only 5-10 minutes. In my case, I like to cook for 20-30 minutes. And some people like to keep really, really cooked. So for 50 minutes, or 1 hour if you want to make really, really, really cooked. And after that, you drain the juice of your protein, adding your protein to your pico de gallo, mixing, and adding some more fresh lime juice and some salt and pepper, and you have the perfect ceviche to eat. Just need some tostada, some tortilla chips, and a really good beer, and cold beer on the side, and
yeah.
You're gonna have a really good one.
Or gelada?
Michelada, yeah, you know that? The seafood place and okay, eating some
let's
good,
turn around and just show her.
Good seafood with a lot of spicy and some michelada and make happy the people here.
I may have to have one now, we're talking about it too much.
The whole lime.
That's
cute. Has the salt and pepper, cilantro.
Okay.
How's your salsa? Good?
What'd you do with your setup?
You need to go around and taste everybody's and you tell us.
Yeah.
Okay.
You're like, yeah, I'll pass.
You make really spicy pico de gallo or mine?
Mild.
Usually I start to try like 3-4 salsa really spicy, I don't feel nothing, so. I never can try too much spicy salsa.
Mm-hmm. Is this my
bowl?
Yeah.
It's
juicy.
Yeah, I really love the serrano and this one. The serrano is adding like a nice fresh and green flavors on this salsa when it's raw. And this salsa usually we like to use the serrano better than the jalapeno. You would have thought people like mine.
Like colores de bandera. Salsa bandera.
La bandera.
Yes.
Everything is nice smaller.
You have a skill to get that small.
The one online.
I'm already thinking about that.
Two online.
Yeah.
I'm going to get one.
I know
she got one. I wonder why it's so I gotta stop. That's the thing about chips and salsa. Mm-hmm. I can't stop eating it.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. I think we need a bit more cilantro. What do you think?
Yep.
There's a part right here.
What about this here?
We have a little extra cilantro right here, and we didn't use.
On this one, you can add some extra cilantro. The cilantro is fresh, and with all the fresh ingredients, it's combined really, really, really good.
I'm gonna put some more in here.
Oh, come on. You need some more of this?
Oh, she took the knife.
Sure, you want me to just cut it off, and then y'all?
Yeah, if you don't mind.
Okay,
thank you.
Do it. I just washed my hands again, by the way. Okay.
And this one, I have the one and a little more serrano, but I really love the flavor of the raw serrano and the salsa. So this is all about the fresh, so for that we like to add more cilantro.
Look at that, Eddie.
Is this the one you made?
Yeah.
I gotta try it. Mine's just good.
Sally.
Are you done, amigos? Yeah?
Almost.
Serrano,
yes. It's not the most spicy today. No, I have some serrano, some more spicy, and maybe with some one serrano you can feel the really nice kick. All right, amigos, can we follow with you guacamole?
Yeah.
Somebody want to help me and decide? You? Don't fight.
I'll help. Oh, you got it.
And one more on this side?
Too.
All right, I'll go.
Yeah? Okay. So in Mexico, we have a lot of different recipes for the guacamoles. And here we have a special recipe for you. It's making with a base of raw garlic and raw serrano chili pepper. And we have here some rosemary on it. That's not really traditional in Mexico, the rosemary and the guacamole. But we tried this recipe like 3 years ago, and we really love the combination of these three ingredients together. So the rosemary is adding really nice fresh flavor on your guacamole, so let me show you this guacamole. So for this recipe, we need a medium clove of garlic. Don't overpass on the garlic is raw, but it's rich with the pepper. Maybe medium cloves. If you have a really big clove, you can add less. If you have a really little cloves, you can add even more. We need around one serrano chili pepper. If you like a little more spicy, you can add a little more chili pepper. If you like my version, you can add less, but we like the flavor of the chili pepper, the serrano special. Special serrano on this guacamole.
Tengo uno.
Yes, it's not over spicy, don't worry. It's just giving a little kick at the end. But for the rosemary and the avocado oil, it like neutralize a little bit the spicy of the chili pepper. Like a medium club, like this size, it's perfect.
Science.
I did, I need some. Oh my god. She laughs at me. We were restaurant. She said, I'm part in the fire.
For this answer, we really want to crush really well all the ingredients, making like a paste. We don't want to bite some big pieces of rosemary or chili pepper really strong on the flavor or spicy. So I recommend to start making a nice paste with the three first ingredients. It's a little hard to crush. So if you need some help, grab Anita. Can I help you, guys? If you cannot do that. Don't mess with anything. You have a ham race, ham, what did you say?
She's an arm wrestling champion?
Yeah, she is.
Of the whole farm?
Yeah.
I believe
San Jose. All right, so you can start to crush your rosemary, garlic, and serrano.
Come on. Rosemary, garlic, serrano. So we need to write that down.
Water likes it.
Right there.
Oh, there.
I used to help
you as the guy
ate on the
spaghetti. Oh, man,
smell
that rosemary. As soon as you start.
I
love rosemary.
Yeah, it smells.
You start crushing it, it's like.
I put in the potatoes, it's awesome. Yeah.
Pepper.
Yeah.
Oh, you thought
it different than me. Oh, no.
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
No, please. Careful. So here we like to show you how to open avocado. Why? A lot of people in all the world get really bad injuries opening avocados.
Really?
So careful, yes.
Yeah.
That's really, really, really bad, the injuries coming from the opening avocados.
I'm staying.
So here we like to say you don't move your knife. So take the knife and roll the ripe avocado on the sharp of the knife. So you don't need to move your knife. Take your ripe avocado and just roll it like that. You don't need to overpress on your avocado. The ripe avocado is some soft.
Yeah.
And sometimes the pit can be like dry or peppery. Mm. So if you overpress on your dry pit, or peppery pit, you can pass through the avocado, pass the pit, and pass the hand.
Yeah.
Twist your avocado and open your avocado. Easy. Then to take out the pit, I always do that in my hand, but if you want to be safe, the best way is putting your avocado on the table, take the pit, and just twist. Easy. To take out the pit of your knife, please never try to take with the hand on the front of the sharp, please. I always pushing with my little fingers like that.
But you can just push on your table, and that's the perfect way to releasing the pit. It is not water.
Burning your mouth.
See?
Mm-hmm. Your stuff.
My stuff is?
We need the paste. So more, amigos.
This is what you wanted us to help. Yeah. I got it now. I see.
Too much work for me.
These guys call it now.
Yeah, you do not do that.
Good trick.
Anita, what's up? I need you.
Oh, well.
Again, someone need help?
Yeah.
Oh, it's looking good, right?
To show you the good way to check the avocado. So a lot of people in Mexico, in all the world, check on the wrong way the avocado and overpress. Sometimes the people take the green avocado, the hard avocado, and overpress with the fingers and think nothing happened. It's hard, nothing happened, I can overpress. But the problem is when it's turned ripe, it's starting to releasing all the brown spot on your avocado. Always the brown spot is like the 99% of the time, it like the finger size, right? All the people overpressing in the avocado. So to check the avocado here, we like to check with the palm of your hand, like giving you lightly pushing and feel the avocado, or with your full hand. Like, never overpress with your fingers, please. This one is a perfect avocado for today. It may be a little hard for you, but always we recommend to take like more little hard like this one, better than the too soft. The too soft, sometimes it's passing and changing the flavors. So you can pass this one around. Don't back my avocado with one spot on it, please. Muy bien, Anita. Yeah. Okay, so we're gonna pass this one around, the little more spicy one, to make you smell the combination of the three ingredients together. So the garlic, the rosemary, and the serrano. Release a really nice fragrance.
That is amazing. You guys like the smell?
Oh yeah. Ooh, smell that rosemary.
Yeah.
Ooh, that smells delicious.
Heavy, no?
Super heavy.
Sure.
Really,
yeah, you never see that
before. Yeah,
I know. But I like it in Mexico with avocados.
Gracias, Anita.
Maybe four avocados on each one.
Okay.
And maybe a little more if we need. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4 avocado. For the avocado, always we recommend to squash really well all the meat close to the skin to add like all the nice green colors to your avocado, to your guacamole. We never squeeze avocado to don't waste the nice green colors close to the skin. 1, 2, 3, 4, and half.
One, two, three. Watch
you
do it, it's really hard.
Then we're gonna add four and half, I think, so to this. The avocado is not always the same size, not always the same size pit, so you need to be sensitive on the quantity of the avocado. It's not an amount.
One knot.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7,
2.
Two.
Two.
Two. One.
Two.
Dos.
Dos.
Siete.
Probably half.
Siete! Oh my God, I need the cooking class. Now here we like to, I like you. So here we like to respect the avocados, the avocado flavor. So we want to keep like the avocado flavors first on your guacamole. The lime is some stronger than the lemon. So the problem, if you have too much lime in your guacamole, the first taste can be twist and keep like the acidity of the lime before the avocado. So usually for this quantity of guacamole, I like to use half lime to one lime. But today for the raw ingredient we use for the rosemary, we're gonna use like a little quarter or third part of the lime. Only that. Just to have a little acidity.
It's a loading. Good question.
And prevent the browning of your guacamole.
Oh, that's it. Cool. Is that a banana paper cut?
Then we need the salt and pepper, and this one we'd like to add some good pinch of black pepper. It's gonna be really good on this guacamole. And the salt, avocado always needs some salt, so we can add like maybe three finger pinches of salt. And mix with it. And make the salt. Okay, so mix really well your guacamole, please. I need you guys to try your guacamole and say me what do you think about the salt, the lime, and everything. Mix really well. And I wanna judge you. What do you think? Need something else?
I need something. It's very good though. Maybe I need to stir it more.
Wow. Unusual, no?
Poco más sal.
The salt is helping a lot to bring the flavor, so that's really important. And we can add a little more like, right? Little. And this one?
Mm-hmm.
All right, let me try yours.
Really tastes good.
That was good.
Is it spicy?
Yeah. Not at all.
No. Yeah.
Not even a little.
It's giving a light kick at the end. That is like from layers. Pretty good. You can add some tomato on the top, like for the Mexican colors, but today we don't want for the rosemary, so we keep like more the original flavors of the rosemary and the garlic. Then
presentation is everything.
Yeah.
All right, muy bien.
Something.
And this one, it's a mild one. The little spicy one, it with the chili on it. And the mild one without the chili on it. Mm-hmm. You can pass and try both guacamole, and after that you can start to make your tortilla with Anita. Yeah. So please pass and try the guacamole, so pass around the guacamole.
If you work here, you don't need a meal.
Very good, thank you.
Yeah.
Nice light right behind you.
Can you get one more bite?
Uh-oh. Did you get some first, babe?
That is so good.
I need to get one more little bite. That's the best part of all your favorite. Thank you.
So, it's outrageous.
Thank you all both of you so much. Did y'all want a spoonful of it on your thing? Continent, really from north to south, but the different thing is that our ancestors would prepare the corn following a process called nixtamalizado. The nixtamalizado consists in simmering the corn for about 20 minutes and afterwards soaking it in food grade lye or calcium hydroxide or limestone for about 5 hours or overnight. This process renders the corn much more digestible, and the human body can
take up the nutrients a lot better. This is very different. Pass it around and touch it. You can even chew on it. It's like an al dente grain, not all the way cooked, but you can chew and it's a little bit resistant. This is very different from the corn that usually you find at any grocery store that is just depleted of nutrients, just mixed with a lot of preservatives and stuff that is just designed to make the product longer, with a stable shelf life, yes. Yes, it's very good. Yes. So families would grow their own corn, harvest it, put it through this process, and then grind it. In very ancient times, it was done with a metate, that is like a tool that you go with a rolling pin to grind it. Now we have this beautiful mill. Anita is gonna show us how she grinds the corn. This is another good workout.
Yeah. That's why Seth's hanging out with her.
Yes. Don't mess with Anita.
Wow. Masa.
¿Alguien gusta pasar? ¿Se da cuenta?
Okay.
¿Y más?
Leos.
Uh-huh. Yeah. <It's cool.
laughs> Anyone else?
Alguien más?
Sure, sure.
I'm done. This is how I make my food from now on. So.
It's okay.
I did my workout for all the stuff
okay,
I ate.
It's okay, señora.
It's okay? No more?
You save up on the gym.
So,
this masa is perfect for tamales, for example, or for atole. I will pass it so you can press it together and feel it. It's like Play-Doh. Don't worry, we are not gonna be eating this masa. We can touch it and play with it. It's okay. Yes, it just has the moisture of the corn kernel that has been soaked. No, nothing else added. To make tortillas, we need to get a finer ground. So we would put it again and grind it one more time. But this is the same masa that you use to make tortillas, tlayudas, sopes,
quesadillas, huaraches,
tlacoyos, which is basically corn masa with something.
Yes.
It folded in different ways. But it's, yeah, that's like the basis of Mexican culinary tradition. And we don't like to waste anything, so any tortillas that is not eaten on the same day will be eaten the next day as in tostadas or tortilla chips or tortilla strips for sopa de tortilla. I mean, we just, and if nobody wants it, the pigs will eat it.
So you use everything.
Yeah, we use everything. Yeah.
Better cheese.
It looks like, sí, like mastica cheese.
La tortilla vamos a pasar otra vez.
Ajá.
Otra vez, sí, dos veces para poder hacer las tortillas, porque así es para tamal. Perfecto,
so it's
para tamal.
Finer. Ajá.
Para tortilla otra vez más, sí.
I missed those.
Tamale. It's just another ground, and she will take a little ball, as in a ping pong size bowl and see if it needs more moisture or if it's okay like that. She will just fill it. Yeah,
it's okay. Aquí tenemos la masa. Está así porque está un poquito seca. Tenemos que agarrar y vamos a amasar, pero tenemos que mojar nuestros dedos.
She feels it is a bit
para
dry, so
amasar la masa. ¿Sí? Vamos. Bien amasadita para que se quede bien la consistencia. Así tiene que quedar para poder
poner
la prensa. Esta es la prensa. Prensa. Hay dos plásticos. ¿Sí? Ponemos un plástico. Ponemos el otro. ¿Okay? Vamos a poner el otro plástico. Y cerramos.
¿Los dos abajo?
¿Perdón?
¿Los dos abajo?
Uno abajo y uno arriba, mira.
Ah, ok.
¿Sí? Uno abajo.
Ya sé.
¿Ok? Y otro arriba de la masa, porque si no le ponemos otro, se pega acá y no es bueno. ¿Sí? Okay, entonces cerramos y vamos a aplastar, pero no vamos a aplastar fuerte, ¿no?
No,
no suave, despacio, lento.
Smooth, we don't need to just go like hard.
Nice and easy.
Nice and easy.
Wow. Wow. Así es. Ahora, si no tenemos la prensa, hay otra manera de que la vamos a poder hacer nuestras tortillas, ¿sí? Vamos igualmente, mojamos. ¿Sí? Y empecemos, amasamos bien. ¿Sí? Para hacer la tortilla. Y, pero pues no tenemos prensa. Buscamos un plástico.
¿Qué
ponemos en la mesa, la barra, donde tengamos un lugar para hacer las tortillas? Ponemos y hacemos. Sí, me hizo de está bien la tortilla así ya. Vamos a comer. Bueno, ahora aquí quitamos un plástico, quitamos uno y volvemos a ponerlo. Y damos la vuelta. Quitamos el otro, ¿sí? Yeah. Tomamos en la mano.
This is to keep the flies away.
Nice.
Some rosemary.
Pasamos al comal. ¿Sí?
Okay, this is the comal. This is where we make our tortillas. It can be cast iron sometimes or clay. In this case, we have this non-stick one. But just check how smoothly she places the tortilla in the comal. It's not just throwing it.
No,
it's like
no botamos. Vamos a poner lentamente, ¿sí?
Smooth.
Muy gentle.
Muy gentle, sí.
Ahora, si no podemos así, vamos con las dos manos. ¿Sí? Y ponemos. ¿Ok? ¿Sí? Ahora vemos si ya se mueve. Sí, es para voltear.
We will see when we can just move it around and the edges start to get brown, we turn it around.
Use our hands.
She doesn't get burned. Be careful as well. She's just
amazing.
She is amazing.
And now the magic will happen. Just look. Because this is the alchemy going on. Like maybe one or two turns, maybe three, and all of a sudden, something will happen. There! That's the corn spirit entering the tortilla.
That's the no preservatives.
Yeah. This is when the tortilla is just perfect.
Perfecta las tortillas.
Right.
It's okay.
Yeah, and that's it. We're done. We go back down.
Yeah. Sí, son perfectas las tortillas. Ah, sí. Okay, now it's your turn. Sí, es perfecta la tortilla. Okay. Sí. Más. Para que no se le pegue, tiene muy bien.
I bet y'all are having a good time out there.
No problem. You want me to get out of your way?
No, it's fine.
Where is hungry?
Maybe it's somebody else.
Oh my gosh, that's beautiful.
Wow.
Okay, amigo, sorry.
Oh my gosh, I thought you said I'm not eating any of Okay. It is like
Filing some butter. The butter is making me some flour. It's really good. The catch of the day is sea bass. You can take one or two. Don't worry, we have more. More fish tacos, don't worry.
Oh, great, yeah, grab it.
You just want one,
baby?
Yeah, I'll grab one.
Okay.
Sunday.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yo voy a cantar esta canción, yo voy a cantar esta canción para mi gente. Con una pasión tan fuerte. Ay, 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 ay. Ahora sigo cantando y sigo gozando. Yo sigo cantando y sigo gozando.
Dame dos cebollitas para tapar el pescado.
Another Pacific Light?
I'm going to the world.